Welcome to Breadboarding. This is the second video in the Breadboard Video Controller series, which is based on top of the original Nanocomp 6809 series of videos that I did, which involved taking a 1981 Wireless World magazine design for a simple 6809 based microprocessor and then extending it to make it more flexible. And in these series of videos, we're going to be extending that basic Nanocomp computer to include a video card, and later we'll also add PS2 keyboard support, among other things. So in the previous video, which was the introduction to the video controller, we identified this plan. So we're on step one of the plan to deploy the basic cathode ray tube controller chip. So that's a 6845 compatible chip from Hitachi. And this will generate the vertical sync and horizontal synchronization signals. We'll also then build the video digital analog converter, which will be used to provide the color signals to the computer monitor. The VGA video standard was introduced by IBM in the PS2 range in 1987. So around the time when the first 6809 computers came around in the early 80s, then this video standard didn't exist. It uses analog red, green, and blue color signals between 0 volts and 0.7 volts and uses TTL levels for the vertical synchronization and horizontal sync signals. Also, these signals can be positive or negative, so effectively inverted or not. And the frequency that the monitor works at can be determined by whether or not positive or negative synchronization signals are used. It replaced the CGA and EGA monitors, and these had digital inputs. So the ability to have analog meant that there was much greater capability for colors. So the VGA included a 256 color palette out of an 18-bit range. So there were some 262,000 possible colors, of which at any point in time, you could choose a palette of 256 compared to CGA and EGA, which both had 16. The fonts were generally 9 dots by 16 dots high or 8 dots by 16 dots. And in this particular case, we're going to be simplifying the design just by using the 8 by 16. We can see here really that the main signals we're worried about are the red, green and blue, horizontal sync, vertical sync, and then we've got quite a lot of ground signals. Video timing for VGA is quite complicated, and there's a great site at tinyvga.com who also sell simple VGA cards that are appropriate perhaps for microcontroller type projects. If you just have a look at those, we're going to be looking at the 640 by 480 with the 25 megahertz clock. We might also look at the 640 by 400, the 25 megahertz clock. Although 640 by 480 tends to be the resolution most people associate with VGA, this in fact is 30 lines by 80 characters, whereas this is in fact the 25 lines by 80 characters is actually this resolution. So depending on what we're wanting to look at, we do 30 rows per page, then we're using the 480. If we're only using 25 lines, then it'd be the 400. So the Motorola 6845, we're going to be using a copy of this, which is made by Hitachi, which is an HD46505. At the time when I was looking at this, I was under the impression that the 6845 couldn't go quite as fast as the 46505, but it looks like from the datasheet that it can both go at a character frequency of about 3 megahertz, which is what we need for doing VGA. So the chip has two addresses in the address space and is configurable by 19 registers. Now, the register select signal, when it's 0, the data bus gives the address that you want to look at, and then when looking at register select 1, then you can then read and write the data. The data sheet for the Motorola part includes a simple register loader program, so we can initialize the various register values fairly easily. The vertical sync signal is effectively the vertical refresh frequency of the display, so typically it would be 60 hertz for a normal page refresh. Horizontal sync is effectively one pixel of the display, and that's typically about 31.5 kilohertz. So each row only takes about 31 microseconds. So if you think the basic Nanocomp clock runs about 1 megahertz and each instruction takes at least 2 clock cycles, the Nanocomp can only really execute about 15 instructions during the period of one horizontal line. So there's not really much that the processor can do in that sort of time. There's a good explanation of cathode ray tubes and the synchronization at the URL that I've included here. That includes some basics about those who may not be familiar. If you haven't used a cathode ray tube controller, an old style TV before, and only used flat screen, then this will explain a little bit about how this was done. So effectively, there was a electron beam scanned across the phosphorus screen using horizontal and vertical magnetic coils. And this is the reason why we have the sort of timing for legacy VGA mode, because effectively the LCD monitors were made to be compatible with that cathode ray tube way of doing things. Choosing the right timing entries for these registers is quite complex. Although there is calculations included in the data sheet, there's actually quite a neat site here for doing the timing. Basically, you can choose the particular frequency and style you want, put in your pixel clock. So we're using 25.175 megahertz, some of your other key things, and then it will give you the register values. So we'll be using these values to initialize our initial registers, but from the experience I've had building earlier versions of the card, you quite often need to tweak these as you try and get them to work. Now the CRTC here has the main lot of signals we'll be using. So the vertical sync and horizontal sync we'll be using now. We'll be needing to wire up the data lines, the chip select, register select, read, write, and E signals. The clock signal is the character clock, so that will be the dot clock divided by 8, so that'll be about 3.1 megahertz. Most of these other lines we'll be using, so the memory address lines are for polling the video RAM and reading each character value, and the row address lines here are used to determine which line of the character is being displayed out of the character storage. So there's normally a raster image of each character, whether it be in ROM or RAM, in our case, and what the RA values say is which row of that character do we want to show at any point in time. So this is the diagram that we had in the previous videos, but all I've done is taken out all of the bits that we don't need to worry about for the moment. So all we're going to be doing is installing the Motorola 6845 compatible chip. We're going to install the 25 megahertz dot clock. We're going to divide that down by 8. And what we're going to be using in this particular design is the normal LSTTL is okay up to about 25-30 megahertz. But one of the things we wanted to do on this series of videos was to use Super VGA and 40 megahertz. Now 40 megahertz is just a bit too fast for LSTTL, but the ALSTTL is generally able to go at 40 megahertz. So a couple of the key chips which are running at the dot clock frequencies, we're going to be using the ALS versions of these, as they're able to run at the 40 megahertz frequency. And over on the right hand side here, the digital analog converter is a simple resistor array, although calculating the values for that resistor array are not particularly simple. And we'll talk about that as we go through and set them up. But basically, we'll be using 4 signals. So in addition to red, green, and blue, we're going to have the intensity as well, which allows us to have sort of a normal red, normal green, blue, and brighter versions of these as well. So it allows us to use 4 bits to determine the color. So it gives us 16 of 8 potential colors. Now, the key thing about the video signal is because it's a high frequency signal, we need to make sure that the impedance of the output of this matches the input impedance of monitors. Now, the monitor's generally always going to have 75 ohms input impedance. And if we don't match these properly or close to them, then you might get degraded video signals and reflections and things like that. And when we're looking at the TTL buffer output, we're not dealing with 5 volts because there is a voltage drop on TTL and we're only getting about 3.4 volts. And what we're trying to do then is divide that down to 0.7 volts as a maximum. Okay, so what we'll look at now is just have a quick look at the schematic. So this is the schematic diagram that we had before. I have reorganized a little bit. So this is all very similar to what we had before. I've got the processor, the buffers, the PLD address decoder, PIA, the serial adapter, the ROM and the RAM. And now what I've done is I've made a bit more space for this by moving the keypad down here. And what we're looking at now is the 6845 and this is going to be wired into the data bus. The chip select goes to the Y3 signal coming out of the address decoder. We've got the usual signals we need to wire in there. We're not going to worry about wiring up Emily's memory address and the row address at the moment. We're only going to worry about the horizontal sync, vertical sync, and the clock signals here are the only things we can fire up at the moment. Our VGA connector is a 15-pin VGA connector. Although it looks quite complicated, I've wired up all of the signals here. Most of these signals are for communicating the monitor, determining what capabilities has, and we're not going to use that. We're just going to wire all those to ground. So in fact, the only signals we really need to worry about are red, green, blue, horizontal sync, vertical sync, and the ground signals. There is a +5 feed as well, and we do need to put a resistor in here to stop the monitor trying to take all its power off the nano comp. So if you just wire that up directly, I found that the monitor drew more than an amp, went on the current limit of my power supply. So if you put a 100 ohm resistor in there, it means that you're not going to end up powering your monitor when it's switched off through your computer. And the values for this resistor array are quite complicated to work out. And although I have got some references on how to do this, in reality, the calculations that these references didn't work out exactly. And to be honest, a bit of trial and error have found compromise, which is closest to the input output impedance and also gives the correct voltage as well. So what we're going to do first of all is to plug in the oscillator. We're just going to see how the signals for a 25 megahertz oscillator here. Then we need to connect this up to the counter here, which is going to divide the signal down by 8. And this circuit here is required to do the clear on when we get to 8. Then this will do the clear to do the divide by 8. We also need to invert the horizontal sync and vertical sync signals coming out of here, because the 60 hertz VGA requires negative sync for both horizontal and vertical. Then we need to invert both of those. In later videos, what we might do is to make these configurable so we can do a register to determine if we have positive or negative sync. For the moment, we're just going to hard code things. Although there is a multiplexer here for taking the output from the character display to determine do we want a 1 or a 0, we're doing foreground or background. We're not going to bother with that for the moment. All we'll do is we'll wire up the colours here just to +5 or ground just for testing. So what this will mean is if this is working, we should get a stable VGA display, but whole screen will all be red, black, white, whatever color we choose. So we won't expect to see anything other than just solid color. So here's the nanocomp where we left it last time. Now what I have done here is I've moved onto a new board. This is an A2 size board, which I got from an art shop. I have printed out a version of the schematic. So I'll be referring to the schematic on the screen in front of me here, but I've got a version of it here that we can check off. So what we're going to do first of all is to put in the oscillator first and probably the divider. Again, what I have done here is try to lay these out according to the breadboard layout. I've already got some new breadboards and added these here. We just need to work out where this is going to go. And what I have done already by printing out the chip labels, what I did earlier is I had a look at how I was going to lay this out for the full implementation here. So to start with, we're just going to be putting in the VGA connector here, clock, the divider, the inverters for the video sync signals, and this one. So that's all we're going to be doing to start with. But okay, now one of the other things that I mentioned in the last of the nanocomp series was I was talking about using breadboard buddies. So breadboard buddies are these little connectors that you can use to plug in for the power rails. Now I'd already put breadboard buddies on the original nanocomp, so you can see over here and over here. What I've actually done here, though, I became aware actually during whilst I was making the last video that Hack Modular also produce two rail breadboard buddies. So this is where you can actually use that across two breadboards. And they also do three rail ones. I don't think there's any four rail ones yet, but that's not really a big issue. So what this means is that you can actually tie multiple breadboards together. And if we were doing something like this one here, you could obviously either do that or have something else down there, or even do it down the bottom. But this is what I'm going to be doing is using these breadboard buddy plus things. So I'll include the link in there for the indie site for Hack Modular, but those are really, really good. So let's have a look at the bits that we're going to be using. So Moving on from my power, so I've made myself another power connector. So if you look at the breadboard power video a couple of videos ago, then this is to make sure that we get good reliable power to the new boards. In particular, when I was doing the first version of this, I was finding that when I was looking at the power down the bottom corner here, this is where you might only get about 3.6 volts. And so obviously things wouldn't work very reliably when you only had 3.6 volts. The VGA connector, I'm actually using this Gravitech little card. So you can buy these from Gravitech. It just has a standard 15 subminiature D connector for VGA. It includes a terminal block, but you can also then put in the 0.1 inch connector. So what I've done is soldered that in there, and I also glued a bit of plastic from the 0.1 inch connector just so that it's a bit more stable and it's plugged into the breadboard. The first version I just bought a cheap one of these connectors, and I soldered the various leads in the back, but it's a bit difficult to do, and particularly all of the ground leads are quite difficult to do. So I'd certainly recommend getting something like this Gravitech connector if you're trying to do this. It's possible to do it with this, but it's a bit fiddly. We've got most of these things have already got the labels on. As I said, some of these are ALS versions. They're a bit more expensive and a bit more difficult to find, but they are a bit faster. So we have the inverters and the counter, which is what we're going to use to divide the clock down. Now, we should say that at 25 megahertz, you don't need ALS. They will work properly at 25 megahertz. It's only if we want to go up to super VGA. This is the HD46505. I think I got those from Silicon Arc. Then we have the 25 megahertz clock. And again, I've put the label on the top so I know which way the pins are. Then we have a NAND gate, a three input NAND gate, which we need for resetting the clock when it gets to 8. And we've got various Hackmonger things and decoupling capacitors. And I've got lots and lots of 3-hole and 4-hole power connectors. So that's the stuff we need to plug in. Okay, so I'm first going to install my power rail, so my Hack Modular power rail here. So we're just going to plug this at the end here. Now my clock here, my oscillator, you can use a simple oscillator crystal and inverters and capacitors to make this, but trying to get that to operate at higher frequencies is more difficult, and particularly when you're dealing with very low capacitances. So I think for a 25 megahertz crystal, if you use inverter, you're using something like 6 or 8 picofarad capacitors, which are getting quite small and very similar to the capacitance you might have between some of the tracks. So we're just going to use this oscillator here. Now, the key thing about this, one of the things I had found in when I was doing an earlier version of this, is if you put your oscilloscope on the tracks beside the output here, you'll find that there's an appreciable sort of 0.25 volt signal appearing on those. So the PCB design of these would normally say you want to leave lots of copper grounded tracks around here. So one of the things we're going to do when we're doing this is any of the rails around the oscillator which are not used, what we're going to do is to ground them, so that we don't get any stray appearances of the oscillator signal other than where we want it. We're also going to need to wire these into the power rails here, and that's generally enough to keep things sort of reasonably stable and secure. It is possible to peel off the backing and to stick them onto the board if you really need to, but in general, once you've got a couple of power rails and all the other bus rails and connections and things, it shouldn't be necessary to connect these two particularly hard. And then we've got our connector here. I'm going to put this in it needs to go in a few holes down. I won't plug it in quite yet, but we want to make sure we can line up wherever possible the different signals to the chips and things we're putting in here. So we'll make sure we've got chips in here, and then we'll plug this in to actually line up wherever possible. In particular, when we're doing the digital analog converter, which is just a number of resistors and things, makes a lot easier if things are going horizontally across here. So we've also got our CRTC chip. That's going to go around here somewhere. We need to allow for probably there's going to be fewer signals going backwards and forwards here. There's obviously quite a lot of pins, but there aren't many types. Whereas over here, we've got sync, we've got row addresses, we've got data, we've got chip selectory. So we need a bit more space on this side. So we're going to leave the three holes on this side and two holes on that side. We are going to have the vertical and horizontal syncs coming around here anyway. So we need a little bit of a gap there. So I think that's our layout should be good for the moment. So as long as we've got the power signals and things are all got power rail, so we'll plug that in. And we've also now got our oscillator here as well. So we'll plug that in. What I'm just going to do now, I won't record this. I'm just going to tie this in, cut some special links to do for here and for down here, here and here. So by tying the power rails there, then it'll give a fairly good physical connection here. Now I've speeded up this, so we're adding the crystal and we've got quite a lot of ground signals, just checking the signal on the oscilloscope. That looked good. Now we're checking our diagrams, putting in the inverter, the counter chip, and the wire in the various power lines first. So the counter chip has a triple AND gate that's needed for doing the clear signal. So we're just checking off all of those. Then we'll start to wire in the various signals which are tied to ground or tied to 5 volts. Check those off. Now we've got to fit in the counter outputs into the NAND gate to ensure that it can reset the counter on 8. And hook in some various signals, reset the E signal and read, write, and the data signals into the CRTC here. So I've put in the data bus going across the board this way because there's different chips are going to need to access the data bus. Just wire in the chip select to the Y3 and wired in the A0 line as well. Now we're going to put in the buffer chip and line up the VGA connector to make sure that things match. That was a prototype board I put together for the resistor values. We're now wiring the sync signals and going to wire in the various resistor values for the digital analog converter. So effectively there's 4 digital inputs into the buffer chip and that are converted into red, green, blue and an intensity. So we can have high intensity or low intensity for all the colors. So it gives us 16 possible colors, which is similar to what the CGA and EGA color standards had. So checking that off. Just needing to put in the additional resistors for the high intensity, the bright signal. And we're also then going to put some insulation on those so they don't touch anything. I need to just remember to wire up signals here. Now I've wired up quite a lot of these to ground. A little bit later I ended up undoing some of them because as I was having problems with getting a signal out, I tried to disable a number of these things to see what was the problem. See here we're just wiring up all the various ground lines, checking those off. So I was just checking the circuit against the diagram again just to be sure, and I realized that I hadn't quite plugged in the read-write signal. So although the read-write signal was coming from here over to here, I hadn't wired it in up chip there, so that's been done. Also that the output of the oscillator hadn't actually gone into the counter here, and there were 2 ground straps for the enable signals and the buffer that hadn't been done. So I've tidied up a few of those, but other than that, it all looks like it's ready to go. I'm going to power it up now, and first thing we do is just check the voltage on the meter here. on the outputs here. Now it should be about 0.7 volts. Our calculations have been correct. That's a little bit low, 6.65 for a good connection. That's 6.566. Six. That's a little below 7 volts, but it should be good enough for what we want. That's showing that we have a clock signal of 25.1.2 megahertz. Period is about 0.4 microseconds. That's about 40 nanoseconds. And peak to peak is a little over 5 volts, just because we've got the bumps at the top and the bottom there. So you can see that this clock is about 3.1 megahertz, but you can see that it's not a 50-50 duty cycle. It's just got this pulse really, which is the pulse that triggers the character loading and the character counting. So that appears to be correct. Now, what I've also got here is the software that we're going to use. This is very much based on the example code that's included in the back of the Motorola 6845 datasheet. It's a very simple program. Basically, our CRTC is at D400. If you remember our PLD configuration, our Y3 signal is at D400. We're now going to use our RAM starting at 00. What it does here is, having initialized the system stack, we use B as the register counter, and we keep on doing this until B is greater than 16, so basically when we've processed the end here. And what we do is we load the count of the byte from here, then we store it. We first of all store the B value in the address register, and then we store the value that we've read from here in the data register. We increment B, go on to the next one. We're also incrementing X for each time. So basically, we read through this list here, and then when we've done the whole list, we then finish. We can't really use a zero as a delimiter here, because we've got zero as a valid value here. So that's the reason why it is B as a loop count here. So it's very simple. All this allows us to do is to initialize the registers. And if we initialize these registers, we should be able to see some sort of valid signals on the CRTC chip. We seem to have the right signals going out to the controller chip, but we don't seem to have anything happening on the vertical sync and horizontal sync. We have the character clock appears to be correct. The only issue with the character clock is it is a different duty cycle. So how wide is this? So this width is 35 nanoseconds. We might just need to check the data sheet, see whether or not this is too short or not. So that was the problem that I suspected. So we were taking the clock signal out of this clear, which comes from the gate down here. However, there is the same frequency signal off the QC out here. So if we go back to the oscilloscope show, you can see here that although it's a 3.1 megahertz signal, the duty cycle is very skewed like this. If I now put this on the QC signal, we put this on the QC output of the counter, we can now see we've got 3.1 megahertz. So what I've done is I've hooked up the output of there to the clock signal on the CRTC. And what I'm going to do now is just to recapture this. And now we're just going to run the program again. And if we now zoom out, right, so what we can see here, we can see there's a vertical sync signal
And if we look at the period of that, it is, if we look at the top right hand side, that's about 59 hertz, which is close enough. It's not quite right, but we can do some fine tuning of the adjustments. And then if we look down at the horizontal sync signal, we can see here that this is now about 31 kilohertz, which again is about what we expect, about 32 microseconds. See, the current clock signal is now, rather than having the heavily skewed duty cycle, we now have pretty regular, and the width is 165 nanoseconds. And if we look in the data sheet for the Hitachi chip that we're using, we can see the clock frequency maximum is 3 megahertz. So we're 3.1, which is close enough, but the clock pulse width is a minimum of 150 nanoseconds. So in fact, we wouldn't never expected this to work, because our pulse width is only about 30 odd nanoseconds. So that was the reason why it wasn't working. I've done a few minor fixes. The issue I did find is that the monitor won't display color if the color signals are not turned off with the display enable signal. Then if they're just a constant always on, then the monitor doesn't display any signal. So what this is now showing is this is on black. What I'm going to do first of all is I'm just going to, so this is with all the inputs, all four inputs at zero, so it's pretty much dark. Just a little bit of signal you can see here is from reflections off some of the red LEDs and things. So this is red, so this is dark red. And then if we now do light red, which will be pink, that's a light pink. It's a dark blue, a light blue. This is a dark green. And a light green. We have all of them on. So this is green and blue. That's cyan. That's darker cyan. We have all of them on. That is close to white, although it's not quite white because the signals aren't quite 0.7 volts. That's a white. And that's grey. Purple there. So in this video, what we've been able to do is to get the basic digital analog converter working. So this is a resistor array attached to a buff chip. And what we have found is that we need to take the display enable signal and adjust the buffer output with the display enable. Otherwise, the monitor won't actually display any video signal, even though the video synchronization was correct. So what I found was that I was getting the correct video synchronization frequency, so about 60 hertz and 31 kilohertz for the horizontal frequency, but it wasn't displaying anything. And it's only when I turned the buffer chip on and off using the display enable signal that this appeared. This just shows us that we've got our data going down to the CRTC, and that we've got our synchronization, horizontal synchronization signals. And we've also shown that we've got the colors coming out on the display. The key thing is we needed to toggle the color output with the display enable for this to work. So thanks for watching. In the next video, what we're going to be doing is adding the character generator, and this will be a memory character generator, which we will load the character generator with contents from the ROM, which will add to the monitor ROM. So the advantage of this is it means that we can change the characters as we want in programmatically, and we can default it to the values in the main ROM, but we can override it if we need to. So this is going to involve adding the character RAM and adding some additional chips to then take the individual rows of bits and rasterize those, and then toggle between foreground and background colors. Now, to start with, our foreground and background are just going to be hard coded, and then in some future videos we will be looking at loading those values from RAM as well. So thanks for watching. If you don't want to miss out on future videos, please hit subscribe, and If you found it interesting, please also hit like. It just helps to make the videos accessible to a wider number of people. Thanks for watching.